Steven Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today, a production of the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today we'll be talking about the Lincoln University and HBCUs. Dr. Robert R. Jennings is president of the Lincoln University, the first degree-granting historically black college and university. Previously, he served as president of Alabama A&M University and chairman of the NAACP Education Legal Advisory Board. Dr. Jennings earned his BA at Morehouse College and his doctorate in education from Atlanta University. Welcome.
Thank you.
Well, we're delighted you came down today. And maybe if you could say a word or two, Dr. Jennings, about what happened yesterday. I know you met with the Secretary of Education about some very serious issues about loans, and maybe if we can explain that to viewers, I think that would be very interesting.
I'd be more than happy to do that, Stephen. I was part of a delegation of about 15 historically black college university presidents that had the opportunity to meet with Congresswoman Fudge, who is the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, and called for a meeting with presidents from our institutions and the Secretary of Education and his staff to talk about the Parent PLUS Loan Program. As you may know, the Parent PLUS Loan Program is a program in which parents could, previous to this year, go into a bank and take out a loan to help their students finance their college education. And they could do that basically on their signature. So if, in fact, the student's tuition was $20,000 and when we applied all of the Pell Grants and other kinds of funding sources that he or she may get, and the parent saw that they were still short, let's say, $3,000 or $4,000, they could go into a banking institution or a lending institution and sign, you know, a promissory note to get that additional $4,000 to pay for that tuition. That changed around February of 2012. The administration decided that they would actually make that program equal to what the other grant and loan programs in the Department of Education were like, and that is if you had some kind of indentation, negative indentation, on your credit report within the last 18 months, then you were not going to be eligible. That caused a number of students who go to HBCUs, and not just HBCUs, because there are more than 1.8 million students in this country, I understand, who were getting Parent PLUS loans. Well, it caused a number of those students to be denied the loan. At my particular institution, about 70% of the students who applied were actually denied. And with that policy going into place during the month of February, when school takes in August, it certainly did not give many options for parents to be able to say, well, what am I going to do if I can't get this loan that I've been accustomed to getting through signing my signature and having the government back it up, then I'm not likely to be able to get it from a lending institution. It sort of devastated most of our enrollments. We took a real big hit at Lincoln because some 400 plus students were not able to return because they didn't have the tuition dollars that they needed. As a result of that loan having been denied. And so that's basically what the Parent PLUS Loan Program is in a nutshell.
Well, why did the government change it in the first place?
Well, from what the Secretary of Staff explained last evening is that there was this policy that applied to other loan programs, but it had never really been equally applied to the Parent PLUS Loan Program. So they started looking at I would imagine default rates. They started looking at one of the examples he gave last evening was that someone who had $7,000 credit limit was being denied when somebody who only had $700 credit limit was being, you know, awarded the loan, and it was not being applied fairly or equally. And so therefore that brought about a change to try to bring some equalization to it, I guess, and apply to that particular program what was being applied to some of the other grant programs or programs in within the department.
Well, this is interesting because it raises all sorts of interesting issues, which is, at least from my perspective, is who's paying for what in higher education and who's expected to pay for what?
Well, the student is expected to pay his or her tuition. And ultimately, you do have to pay your tuition, because while you may get the loan, as many of us who went to college on loans, you eventually have to pay that money back. And most parents don't end up paying it back, even though they may have signed for you to get the loan. The student, once he or she starts to graduate and get a job, start to pay those loans back. And so the student is in fact expected to pay the loan. So it's not the government actually giving you anything. It's, you know, making it possible for you to get a loan to finance your education. But you are expected to pay it back.
But then the counterpoint to that, and I certainly understand this issue because it's affected a lot of my students as well.
Okay.
But if you think about it from a perspective, from a public policy perspective, what happens if somebody can't afford something? Should they go to a less expensive option?
You mean a less expensive
university, perhaps?
Institution?
Yes, and that's where, it kind of gets right to the heart of who pays for education in the United States. Because from a consumer standpoint, you could say, well, if I can't afford X, then I have to go to X minus 2 in terms of what I can afford. But on the other hand, as a matter of public policy, we certainly want to encourage kids to get the best education they possibly can.
Yeah. Well, that is always the case, that you need to be trying to acquire an education at the level at which you can afford. Though you may have a certain institution that you're interested in attending. And we really do want students, first and foremost, to attend those institutions where they have the ultimate desire to do that, because the research shows that they have a tendency to do better when they're at a school where they really have a desire to be there, as opposed to going to the school down the street where their interest really may not be that high. So I certainly would say, yeah, get what you can afford. But ultimately, you have to pay it back. So we're asking the government, or what students have been asking the government to do, is to help me finance my education, regardless as to where I'm going, with the understanding that once I start to work, and now they require you 6 months after you graduated to start paying that loan back, I will start to make good on that loan. I will start to pay that money back. So that's kind of the way it works.
Fair enough. Well, would you mind saying a word or two about Lincoln University? Because I'm not sure our viewers know that much. Some viewers know quite a bit about the storied history and the storied traditions of Lincoln, but I'm not sure everybody does.
Be delighted to talk about my institution. You may have to cut me off. Lincoln is the oldest degree-granting institution for persons of African descent in the nation. We were founded in 1854. This year we will celebrate 160 years of existence. We are very delighted about that. We have graduated leaders in almost every domain that you could possibly imagine. Some of our most outstanding graduates are Thurgood Marshall, the first U.S. Supreme Court Justice of African descent in this country, Lillian Fishburne, the first black woman promoted to the position of Rear Admiral, Langston Hughes, the great Renaissance poet that everybody quotes and everybody tends to know. His work is taught in schools all over the world. It goes on and on and on. The first president of modern-day Ghana, Kwame Nkrumah, the first president of Nigeria, Nami Azikiwe, all of those are Lincoln graduates. And not just those individuals who have been long gone off the scene, but when you look at even the current day individuals that we have produced, when you look at the highest-ranking black woman in the New Jersey legislature, she's a Lincoln graduate. When you look at one point in our history, about the first 100 years of our history, we have produced 20% of all black lawyers in this country, male black lawyers, because Lincoln started as an all-male institution. And we have produced 20% of all black men in this country who were lawyers, and about 21% of all black doctors in this country. So we are very proud of that history. Currently, we offer about 33 programs, degree programs, at the baccalaureate and the master's level. We have an enrollment today of about 2,000 students. We are trying to grow that. That would have, without some of the things that occurred with the Parent PLUS loan, that enrollment would have continued to grow, but that has had a devastating impact on our enrollment. But that's sort of us in a nutshell. We're located in Southern Chester County in Pennsylvania. And that's about it in a nutshell, I guess.
Well, fair enough. In terms of you're here representing not just Lincoln, but also HBCUs. Could you say a word or two about what's happened to HBCUs in the last couple of years in terms of enrollment and in terms of some of the trends?
Yes. There are in this country about 105 historically black colleges and universities. Most of us are members of NAFEO, the National Association for Equal Opportunity in Higher Education, and those of us who are public schools are members of the Thurgood Marshall College Fund. And there are about 39 or so who are members of the United Negro College Fund. Though all of those are private institutions, like Morehouse College, where I graduated from, and several others. There are about 105 altogether. There are also a bunch of predominantly black institutions. They are not historically black institutions, but they're predominantly black institutions. But of those 105, I would say the majority of them educate students of African descent, though we have always been very diverse institutions, both in terms of student population and faculty. A good example is that at Lincoln, we have students who represent 33 states and 17 foreign countries. We have a very diverse faculty of people from all over the world with all kinds of experience and all kinds of degrees from all kinds of institutions. And we think that makes for a good global environment in which we are operating to produce a student who is globally minded.
Well, in terms of the history of Lincoln, I was a little confused about this because I thought Lincoln was a private school originally and then became a public school. Did I get that right?
We started out as a private institution, and in 1972, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania legislature added four schools to its roster of what's called state-related institutions, meaning that they would start to provide some support for these institutions. So we are in a category of what's called state-related institutions. Not state-supported, but state-related. There are about 13 or 14 state-supported schools, meaning they all come up under one umbrella and that there is a president or chancellor that kind of directs some of the activities for those institutions as a group. I'm in a group with Temple University, Penn State, and the University of Pittsburgh and Lincoln are in what's called state-related institutions, meaning we have our own separate board, though we do have members appointed by the legislature and the governor to our board. But we have our own separate board that governs the institution itself.
And you report to one board of directors or two boards?
No, I report to one board, and that is the Board of Trustees at the Lincoln University.
And speaking of trustees, one of the things that also intrigued me about the history of Lincoln was the relationship that the university had with the Barnes Foundation.
Okay.
Could you say a word or two about that? Because I think a lot of people may not have followed that crazy history about moving the Barnes collection from suburban Philadelphia to Center City, Philadelphia.
Right. Dr. Barnes, whose collection it is, was a good friend to our president, Dr. Bond, who is Julian Bond's father. And they were personal friends, and so upon his death, he left in his will that he didn't necessarily want a museum. He wanted his works to be put into a foundation for the purpose of educating and the aesthetic quality that it brings about to one's life, and a number of issues such as that. And he left in the will that there would be a foundation board comprised of five individuals, four of whom would be recommended by the Lincoln University. And so for years, 30 years or more, we had such an arrangement. And then a few years ago, it was decided that the foundation needed to get more visibility, more clout, much more exposure to providing, hopefully, what he really intended, and that there was a need to move it from suburbia, Pennsylvania, to the Parkway, where there are a number of museums and a number of people who come from all over the world to see the kind of art that we have in the city of Philadelphia. And so there was some changes made to increase the board from five to 15, with Lincoln still remaining, having five voting members on that board. But there would certainly be other people who could help to expand the vision and the mission of the foundation. We have a long-standing relationship, and I, as the president, who have come in and sort of tried to take and strengthen that relationship so that we have an agreement that sort of lays out what it is we want to be about. So our students get teaching experiences, they get internship experiences at the Barnes now. We have some classes that are offered there. We have some of their faculty or some of their employees who help to teach courses on our campus. We can do some things online. We can do some things face-to-face. And so it has strengthened the relationship.
Yeah. And speaking of different relationships, do you have relationships with other universities in Pennsylvania or other universities around the world?
We do. We have fairly strong research relationships with the University of Pennsylvania, certainly the University of Pennsylvania at Hershey. A lot of our STEM research is done in collaboration with them. We have professors on our campus who are doing research in collaboration with the University of Massachusetts and students who travel both to those institutions. We have some a relationship with University of Iowa where students are doing research there. Since I've been at Lincoln, I've signed 13 articulation agreements with community colleges. So now we have relationships where those students who complete their first 2 years at those community colleges don't have to repeat that kind of work when they come to Lincoln. They come to Lincoln and complete their last 2 years and get a bachelor's degree. So we have a number of relationships with schools around the country.
And speaking of the community colleges and the articulation agreements, how does that kind of compared to what the president's trying to do in terms of undermatching?
Well, I think that this administration, President Obama, is about the business of trying to make certain that between now and 2020, we have the most educated populace in the world. And certainly we want to be one of the main players when it comes to STEM, the STEM areas. And so, he has given a special allocation, I know, to community colleges to try to help them attract and retain students. He has certainly made it known that he would love to see a stronger alliance between two-year colleges and four-year colleges. And so that sort of helps all of us working in the same direction, because the bottom line is that we do want to try to achieve that goal of helping to make certain that we have an educated populace in this nation.
But how do students do that if they're encouraged to go to certain community colleges on one hand, but on the other hand, somebody's telling students, well, you're not great if you're going to community college because you need to match better?
Well, I do know that a good bit of the students who, and according to the research, only a small percentage of students who go to community colleges and graduate end up living and maintaining the quality of life that they so desire to have. They get to a plateau where they can't go any further without that bachelor's degree. And in many instances, the bachelor's degree is not even what you need. You need much more than that. And so what tends to happen is we do want to maintain community colleges so that students can get that good foundation, ease back into it as many of them need to do from the high school experience, especially when they didn't come right out of high school and go right to college. So that's a mechanism by which we can continue to make that happen. But we also want to maintain relationships so that you continue to leave the community college with that associate degree and come right onto a four-year institution and get the bachelor's degree, because that's what you're going to need if you want to keep moving up the ladder in whatever domain that you've chosen as your field of work. And so in terms of matching, you do need to be able to make certain that your skill sets are going to match up with the four-year institution that you're trying to get into. We have to make certain that the courses that you've taken are going to meet our standards, because if not, you're going to have some difficulty trying to get through the remaining 2 years, which for the most part is going to be a focus on your major, what you're actually trying to major in, and trying to take it to another level. So that's kind of the way that has to play out.
Well, and you mentioned in terms of getting through, what's happened since you've become president in terms of graduation rates at Lincoln?
Well, our graduation rates have stabilized. We're certainly trying to increase those graduation rates. But there again, we have the kind of student who does not often stop out because of academics. They stop out mainly because of finances. We have a very small percentage of students who have to drop out because of academic performance. In fact, it's less than 2%. Most of our students who drop out are dropping out so that they can go get a part-time job or even sometimes a full-time job to continue their financing their education. The fear in that is that oftentimes students will get out there, start making that money, it starts to get good to them, and they often don't return, or they certainly don't return at the rate that we'd like to have them return. That sort of counted against us because that goes against our retention rate or our graduation rate, which we in fact had little or no control over. So you can't hold us accountable for the fact that he stopped out or dropped out. And oftentimes, even when they stop out or drop out, they go to another institution that may be closer to them or that may be lesser in cost for them or any number of factors that they may have to apply in order to continue their education. They're often not counted, and that's counted against the institution where they left from because they never returned back to us or they left us. And so that sort of impacts, if you will, our retention or our graduation rate when, in fact, those are sometimes factors for which we could not control.
But what happens when you've got students who, on one hand, may not have the money that they need to go to school, and the government is saying, okay, we're going to give you these loans or allow you to take out loans to function in the future, but then we have very serious rates where students don't finish, and then what happens is that students are saddled with debt without the degree.
Well, that is, in fact, a problem. We certainly do not want students to be saddled with debt. And also, if that happens and they don't pay the loan back, then it impacts our default rate. So the college gets branded for it as well. But I think I would probably end up saying to you what I heard one of the university presidents say last night when we were meeting with the Secretary of Education. That's probably a smaller price to pay in terms of having an educated populace than us doing nothing and having people who end up on the other side of that spectrum where they may end up being incarcerated, and then we're going to pay one way or the other because we're paying in less taxes, we're paying to keep people incarcerated and all of the kinds of things that come with that. So that amount of money is so small in comparison to what is happening on the other end of that spectrum, until that's probably not something we really ought to get hung up on, if you ask me.
Well, one of the comments that people have made in the education department is that the question is whether or not the same number of HBCUs should exist as have always existed. What do you think about that? Because if you look at kind of the women's colleges, I mean, a lot of people have claimed that the women's colleges, that there were many more women's colleges, and unfortunately we have fewer and fewer of them because of the financial pressures. But is the same thing going to happen to HBCUs?
Well, I certainly have no way of knowing that. And on the other hand, I would say I hope not. Most schools have a mission, and sometimes those missions are very unique, and that they serve a purpose that if you start to combine them with other institutions, that mission may have to change, and the people that they were serving, many of whom got an education from that particular institution because that was the only place that they could possibly go for any number of reasons. It might have been locale, it might have been cost, it might have been because people tend to work with that kind of student in a different way than what they would find if they went to a larger institution or another institution who did not have that as their thrust or their mission. So I would certainly hope that that is not the case. I would also say, though, that we have to be realistic. If there are institutions that are hanging on by a thread and they see that they are not going to be able to provide a quality education because of their financial plight, then the smart thing to do is to look at other alternatives. And one of those alternatives might be to try to see if they can merge with someone who is close by that would help them to maintain providing the kind of service with the kind of mission that they have to the population that they are trying to serve.
Well, fair enough. We only have another minute or two left. If you wouldn't mind speaking directly to some students, a lot of students and parents watch this show. What advice would you have for students and parents thinking about going or about to go through the admissions process and about to look at colleges?
Well, first and foremost, I would want to encourage any and all students to consider very seriously the Lincoln University. We think we are a unique institution. We have a diverse student population. You don't have to be an African American to come to our institution. We have students from, as I said, 33 states and 17 foreign countries. We have, it's a very global place, and so I would encourage students. I would also say to students that you need to start looking at colleges as early as possible. It's not too early to start looking in 10th grade. You need to start really in the 9th grade. But I would certain no later than the 10th grade. You need to really try to make up your mind as to what it is you think you want to do in life and start trying to narrow and focus in on that. We still see a sizable number of students all over this country who come to college and really haven't decided what it is they want to do or want to be about in life. Those students tend not to do as well as some of those who've sort of honed in on the fact that I really want to be a scientist or I want to be a nurse or a teacher or whatever. As soon as you can kind of narrow that focus, then you need to start trying to read everything you can possibly get your hands on about that particular area of study. And so that you start to become more informed as to whether or not this is really what you want to do. I would also encourage students that if they're going to get part-time work, or if they can try to get internships, both paid or unpaid, that they need to start as early as possible, trying to get those internship experiences in that particular area that they think that they're interested in. Again, that's going to help them to really kind of decipher whether or not this is really what I want to do in life. And then it may be that they need to pick two or three things so that if that first one that they try their hand at is not something that they're interested in, they can say, well, this is a second area of interest. And there's always a battery of tests, career placement tests that you can take that will help you to sort of tell you what you might be best at.
Well, thank you, Dr. Jennings.
Sure, thank you.
If you would like additional information about Dr. Robert R. Jennings, please visit lincoln.edu. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at higher education today@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Steven Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.